Welcome to Family Worship Center. Family Worship Center is the home church of Jimmy Swaggart Ministries in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. We welcome thousands of media church members tuning in worldwide on the Sun Life Broadcasting Network, the Sun Life Radio Network, online at sunlifetv.com, on Facebook Live, and on the free SBN Now app. This morning's service will begin soon. Now let's go live to the Family Worship Center Sanctuary. It's time for the Sunday morning service, live from Family Worship Center at Jimmy Swaggart Ministries in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. We'll have music from the Family Worship Center singers and musicians and a powerful message from God's Word. Now we go back live to the Family Worship Center sanctuary.
Thank you. think about where he's brought you from this morning? Can you think about how he pulled you up out of the miry clay and set your feet upon a rock? He's good.
Praise God.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, just speak your praises to him this morning. Thank you, Jesus. We love you, Lord. We magnify your name. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. I come to the garden.
someone and welcome them into the service. We're so glad to have all of you and those of you joining us by Sun Life Broadcasting Network, television, radio, internet, streaming live on YouTube and Facebook. We're so glad to have you. And now that service has begun, make sure you turn off all your cell phones so there won't be any disturbance. And boy, we want to thank everyone that helped us Friday in the Bible-thon. We had a tremendous Bible-thon. Over grand total, 45,810. This is the first time that we've had back-to-back months of over 45,000 Bibles. We thank the Lord for that. Going into Honduras, and then we finished Honduras, and we started on Pakistan, and we got a good chunk of that out. We'll pick Pakistan back up next month, and I want to thank Pastor Kenny Flaming for driving over. When he takes these Bibles, this will be his third or fourth trip to Pakistan to distribute Bibles and sharing with us the stories of how these Bibles are impacting pastors and workers and sharing pictures. We just had a great time, and I want to thank him for helping us. Well, it's good to be back home. Last week, are you glad I'm back? Somebody like, maybe so, I don't know. But we was in South Africa. Had a great, great trip, and had quite a few people respond for salvation. And Sunday night, we had scores filled with the Holy Spirit. And we just thank the Lord for that. But you know, you never can tell who you're gonna meet when you're out and about, especially overseas. And I was out with the pastor. We were doing a little sightseeing, and I got to meet someone who the ministry has greatly, greatly impacted. And it was just, I took a picture and brought it to bring it back. And yeah, this is Pastor Seal. And he shared with me what the ministry has done in his life. And he was called to preach. And he took me out and shared with me showed me his congregation. We have a picture of that. That's Seal Assembly. They're all laying before the Lord, slain in the spirit. And but really, when we were there, this was a place called Seal Island. But while we were waiting for the boat, one of the tour guides, and he kept looking at me. And he walked over to the pastor and spoke Afrikaans, but he was asking, who is that? And he told him, and he came over with a big smile on his face telling me, said, we watched the ministry for years, and I can't tell you what the ministry has done in my family's lives. And so we give the Lord thanks for that. I met folk there that were in all of our, that's been in all of our crusades. We had a major crusade there in Cape Town in the big soccer stadium. Actually, I wound up staying just about a block from there on this trip and met so many people in the services that were in those crusades and in those meetings. And so it was just so good to meet them and be a part. But it's good to be back home. And amen. Also today, I want to recognize, we're so glad to have, this month I was in Cape Town. Last month I was in Montevideo, Uruguay, had a great meeting. And brother and sister Alexis Medina, the pastor of the church, they're here this morning. Would you stand, pastor? We want to welcome you and your wife. Both of you stand. Sister Medina, stand. He has the largest Assembly of God church in Uruguay, and he's also one of the nationwide officials for the Assemblies of God. And when he was much younger, he worked in our office there in Uruguay. And he has a wonderful work. He's doing a great work for the Lord, and we're so glad to have him visiting with us this morning. Camp meeting is less than a month away. Resurrection Camp Meeting, March the 27th through the 31st. Those of you watching, we want to invite you. If you haven't made up your mind, I just made it up for you. You're going to get your car, you're going to get on an airplane, you're going to fly, you're going to hitchhike, you're going to drive, you're going to get down here to Baton Rouge, and you can go to jsmcampmeeting.org, jsmcampmeeting.org, for more information, all the hotels in the area that give discounts for campers, and as well, if you are coming, we've already got some people that I met this morning, they have come in for camp meeting this early to be here the whole month, and we're honored for that. And but go to jsmcampmeeting.org, and if you are planning on coming, we need you to go to that website and register. That helps us to plan accordingly to make sure that we've got enough of our staff on hand to make sure that your time here is going to be a great time. But it's going to kick off on Wednesday night. Gabe will be kicking it off, and then Thursday, as you know, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, three services a day, and Bishop Tim Hill will be back with us. Pastor Tommy Bates will be back with us, and it's going to be a great, great time. Also, I met a dear sister in the lobby this morning that has come to Baton Rouge to celebrate her 90th birthday. Sister Annie McLeod from Maryland. Where are you, Annie? Where are you? Stand up, stand up, stand up. 90 years old. Why don't you sing birthday, happy birthday? Her name is Annie. We'll sing happy birthday to you.
Happy anniversary.
No, happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy anniversary. Happy birthday.
She said this was, to be here was on her bucket list. This morning we want to welcome 68 brand new Family Worship Center Media Church members from 26 states and three countries, from Alabama, TJ, California, Darlene, Ed, Sally, Colorado, Deborah, Gretchen, Jeremy, Linda, Wesley, Florida, CK, Gail, Michelle, Tim from Georgia, Heather and Keith, Illinois, Charlie, Danny, Patty, Indiana, Gracie, Tracy, Iowa, Donna, Jennifer, Kathy, Michael from Kentucky, Elijah from Louisiana, Anthony, Deborah, Leanne, Lenny, Olivia from Maine, Jana, Lauren, Massachusetts, Loretta from Michigan, David from Minnesota, Christopher, Shannon
from Missouri, Jason, Melba, and Stanley from Nevada, Robert from North Carolina, Oliver from Ohio, Jennifer, Joseph, Russell, and Tori from Oregon, Shirley from Pennsylvania, Barbara and Chris from South Carolina, Kathy and Rebecca from Tennessee, Billy, Elizabeth, Patricia, Todd and Zane from Texas, Angel, Rosita, Susan and Marty from Virginia, Barbara and Susan from West Virginia, Hugh and Robert from Wisconsin, Daniel and Joanna from Brazil, Mari from Germany, Johannes and from Norway, Birjan. Would you stand, Family Worship Center, look over here to this camera to our left, and let's welcome all of our brand new Family Worship Center Media Church members. And we are delighted to have you joining us today. Family Worship Center, Resurrection Choir and Singers. for that second verse one more time, please. Church, you may be seated for a second. It is appointed once for every man and woman, boy and girl, to pass on. But you see, there is a difference for the Christian. Because when the child of God breathes their last breath, my Lord, I feel that they're going to wake up in eternity with Jesus Christ, where they will live in peace forever and forever. Are you looking for that day, church? Are you looking for that moment? That second verse, one more time, please. To understand, church, this life is not going to be one of ease. It's not going to be one of just pure pleasure. There's going to be some difficulties that we're going to experience here in this earthly journey. But I've got news for all of you right now, and even though that you may be in the midst of some of the darkest days that you're facing in your life right now, we have a promise that we can hold on to as people of God, and that is this: regardless of what we're facing, regardless of what we're going to be facing in the future, we have a promise that says this: we are able to go up and take the country and possess the land from Jordan to the sea. Although giants may be there our way to hinder, church, my God, I said, my God has given us the victory. Let me have some HG. Chad, please. I want you to start singing this and believing it here this morning. We are
able. We are able to go up and take the country.
This opportunity to pass out the ingredients for taking the Lord's Supper this morning. And we always like to say every single month as we get ready for this moment that there's something that we've got to understand regarding the taking of the Lord's Supper. As important as it is, The act of taking the Lord's Supper will not do anything for the individual, but it's actually what it represents. And we like to say it this way: every single day, we must understand that our faith must be anchored in Jesus Christ, who He is and what He's done. If your faith is not anchored completely, exclusively in the finished work of Christ, it could cause us harm. And I do not want harm to come upon any one of us. And at this moment right now, if you're not sure if your faith is anchored in Christ, all you've got to do is say, Lord, I believe that my faith is anchored in what you've done. As the ushers are passing out the ingredients, I want them to sing whatever they feel led to sing just for a moment. And I want just to have this opportunity of worship and praise and thanksgiving as we do this. Just for a second, go ahead, Brian, if you could sing something, please.
Oh, it reaches to the high.
Oh, it reaches to the highest
mountain. And it flows to the lowest valley.
Oh, it's the blood that gives me strength.
Oh, the blood that gives me strength from day to day. It will never lose its power.
Go ahead and read that, please.
For I've received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me.
Hold the wafer up in your right hand and crush it between your fingers and take it this morning.
After the same manner also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do you as oft as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he come.
Hold the cup up this morning and take it. Amen. Well, do you love Jesus this morning? Come on, church, do you love Jesus this morning? You may be seated. We welcome you this morning. We are delighted to have all of you joining us. And if you are a first-time visitor, then we welcome you. And we like to say it this way: you won't leave here like you came, in Jesus' name. And I'm just believing God for some great, great services, not only today, but tonight as well. And as you know, we have our very special guest speaker ministering on both services, so we're expecting God to do some great things here this morning. Are you expecting God to do some good things here? Well, are you ready for some more music? John, Colin, Randy, as they come before you today, they're going to play you a song that the devil thought that he had for his own. But we just serve a notice on the devil. We're taking that song back. Because when the saints go marching in, it's not talking about the New Orleans Saints. It's talking about every single saint of God who's ever lived. Come on, guys.
Oh, Are you looking forward to that day? Now when we gather round the throne and the gates are closed within, I'll be shouting glory, hallelujah, when the saints go marching in. Now when the saints, they go marching in.
Saints go marching in. I'm telling you, I love that. That is amazing. Would you stand? We're going to take up our tithes and the offerings for Family Worship Center today, and we want to thank you so much, not only for what you did for us on Friday, but what you're going to do for us today and tonight. And we thank you for those of you that are watching and listening somewhere around the world. You can participate in this offering as well. Call the number on the screen, or you can go online right now. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we come before you in the name of Jesus, and we thank you so much for all that you've done and are doing for your people. Continue to pour out your blessings upon each and every one. And we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. March around this morning, please.
Jesus got a hold of my life, won't let me go.
Jesus came into my heart, into my soul.
This song that I will attempt to sing, and you'll have to forgive me, I broke a tooth off at the gum line, and I look like somebody shot me with a gun. Somebody said, well, why didn't you go get it fixed? Well, have you ever tried to find a dentist? We have an excellent dentist in the church, but at 10 o'clock Saturday night, I don't think you're going to find one. So if you hear a whistling sound, I want to tell you, I like that song. Y'all just stood up on your hind legs and played the music and sang the song. My. To glorify the Lord. Have you ever stopped to think what it was like for thousands of people in Israel playing tambourines and singing and shouting and praising God? It had to be a wonderful, wonderful sight. The man that wrote this song that I will attempt to sing tonight, not this morning rather, I want to say was not a believer, but I don't think that's the right way to say it. He believed in Jesus Christ. He believed in heaven, he believed in hell, he believed in the Word of God. And he believed that you must accept Jesus Christ to be saved. But there is no record of his accepting Christ. And yet it's a good possibility he did. And the man that wrote the melody for Amazing Grace was not a Christian. Think about that. John Newton wrote the words. Unless he gave his heart to Christ at the last moment. Let it bless your heart. I'd rather be in a deep, dark grave, know that my poor soul was saved, to live in this world in a house of gold, deny my some people steal, they cheat and lie for wealth and what it will buy. But don't they know that on the judgment day, gold and silver won't pass away? Mm-hmm.
This is the fourth year in a row that we've had the privilege of hosting Pastor John Mosbach from The Hague in the Netherlands, Holland. And his family, as we've mentioned before, but I'm saying it for the sake of television, his dad is one of the greatest Pentecostal pioneers that Europe has ever seen. And I've had the privilege of ministering for his brother David in their home church there in The Hague. And wonderful people, wonderful family. And we're so honored once again to this morning and tonight, all the way from the great country of Holland, Pastor John Mosbach. John, come and bless these people. We're so glad and honored to have you once again.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for this warm welcome. It's always a joy to be in Family Worship Center. I tell you, you have one of the greatest worship places in the world. And what you are so blessed, so blessed, so blessed. Also, all those that are watching online. And I must greet you from Holland, from my brother David, who's the president, and his family, my own wife and family, and also Brother Swaggart and your wife, from my mama. She will be 97 in a few months. And she's praying for you. She watches you all the time. And I know that she dearly loves you too. So we're very blessed in Holland. And God is doing a great work. He's doing a great work. In the midst of all the chaos and controversy in the world, God is doing a great work. And you are so part of what He is doing. I tell you, I come all over the world and I hardly come to a place where they don't know Jimmy Swaggart Ministries, where they don't watch you, where they're not blessed by you. And so please know that you are a blessing to the world, and we appreciate that. And also last year, we were so thankful to have Brother Donnie with us. You preached powerful. You were wonderful, used by the Lord, and we hope you will be able to come back soon again. Well, we better go quickly to the Word, because I do have something I must share with you, something that the Lord put upon my heart. And let's start with a few scriptures. And just a sentence here, Isaiah 55, verse 1. Everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. Today we're going to talk about the inflow and the outflow of the Holy Spirit. You need to have an inflow of the Holy Spirit if you also want to have an outflow of the Holy Spirit. You know, in Holland we have a saying, I don't know the Dutch equivalent, maybe you can help me, Brother Donnie, but we say, you cannot pluck any feathers from a bald chicken. Now, I don't know how that would go over in English, but it's a good saying in Holland. You cannot pluck any feathers from a bald chicken. And it's the same with the Church of Jesus Christ. You cannot expect a movement of power. You cannot expect God to do something if there is nothing inside that church. You need to have something inside. And what we can have inside is nothing less but the Holy Spirit Himself. Hallelujah. How wonderful that we are so blessed. Yeah, when I get excited like that, I make a little jump like that. But you'll get used to that, I think. Let's go to another scripture here. John 7, 37. Now on the last and most important day of the feast, Jesus stood and called out in a loud voice, if anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. What an invitation. Are you thirsty? Thirst is a good thing. Hunger is a good thing, because it'll make you to seek for the water of life and for the bread of life. Revelation 21, 6. And he said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. And to the one who thirsts, I will give water from the fountain of the water of life without cost. John 4, 13 and 14. And please excuse me this morning. I took it from the Amplified Bible here. It has a few additions here that I really like, and I'll get into that in a moment. Jesus answered her, everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again,
but never be thirsty again. Yes. You know, sometimes I don't have the words, you know, so I just, you know, like, yeah. You do that here too? Yeah, okay. Some shouts like that. Yeah. But the water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water, satisfying his thirst for God, welling up, continually flowing, bubbling within him to eternal life. I like that. Welling up, bubbling. Do you have something bubbly in you? Are you alive? I saw that song that you were singing, Oh, When the Saints, and I saw you all standing at your seat, and I had a problem to keep standing there be in front of my chair because I just wanted to start marching through the auditorium, you know. I remember those meetings we had with my father. Oh, let me tell you, he would have an anointing service. Now, these days when they anoint you, they have those little anointing roller balls, you know, and they put a little. But my father, when he would anoint, I don't know how you do it here, but my father, he would have a big ball of oil. And, you know, they would sing the songs like When the Saints, and people would get in the line. It would take hours, you know. And he would put, he didn't have small hands. He had big hands, you know. And he'd slap it in that oil. I tell you, it'd be dripping, dripping there. And he'd slap it on your face, you know. Whoom over you. You'd be oil everywhere. You saw some women with a wig, you know, they would come like, they want to protect their wig. One time he slapped it on and he went over the head and the wig went everywhere. But Spirit was there and nobody kept, somebody quickly put it on again, you know. And the songs would sing and the presence of God in the auditorium would be so heavy that people would already be drunk in the Spirit, you know, as they came. So they would come in the line like this, you know, and they'd be singing. And then we had the brothers standing there and they would put up the hands. So they would come and they already fell almost before my father even touched them, you know. And then he would touch them and they would fall. And you had young men like me at the time who had rolled up sleeves and we would have to carry them away, you know. And the ladies would come to put the cloth over the skirt, you know. It was all official. But I remember one day there was this woman coming in the line. She was big size, big size. And my father saw her coming. And he turned to me, so he's anointing, you know. And he turns to me, he says, don't let that woman fall. Now, again, he says, listen to what I'm saying. Don't let her fall. And she's coming, you know, like this. And so I walk to her, and he looks at me with a look. You know that, brother. You know it, Brother Gabriel, when Papa looks like that. So I put my hand under her armpit, you know, to keep her up. And she says, what are you doing? What are you doing? I said, nothing, nothing, nothing. And we're going there. She's looking at me like, let me go. Papa's looking at me. Don't let her fall. So he anoints her. And she is saying to me, let me go. I want to fall. Let me go. I want to. And Papa, his eyes are burning in me, you know. Don't let her fall. But suddenly, she just gives all her weight like, I couldn't keep her up. I couldn't keep her up. She fell on the floor. Papa looks at me. I told you not to let her fall. Roll her under the piano. Now, me and we would be together, you know, carrying together. So, roll her under the piano. So, I took her legs, he took her arms, and we rolled her under the piano. He was so upset. Yeah. You know, I don't know how it was here, but in olden days, in front of the monitor, we always had flowers there. So it began with fresh flowers, but there came a moment we had fake flowers, you know. And it was a nice bouquet. And so Papa, while he's preaching, he goes to the flowers. He says, They look nice. They look real, don't they? They even smell real. But they're fake. Just like some Christians. And then he went on to preach again. They look real. They even smell real. But you can feel it. They're fake. Just like some Christians. That woman, he knew she had an unclean spirit. And he didn't like it when it was fake. Now, some people, they have a problem accepting the Holy Spirit. And maybe you're watching, because in the auditorium, I don't think there's a problem here. But maybe you're watching at home and you have a problem because there's also fake. And there is also fake. Now, I haven't really seen a lot of fake pebbles, but I saw some fake diamonds. Now, why do they make fake diamonds? Because it is precious. It is valuable. Why is there also some fake Holy Spirit things going on? Because it's precious. It's valuable. You need it. But because there is some fake, are you going to deny yourself the real thing? Are you going to say, I don't want this because there's also fake going around in the world? Yes, there is some fake going around in the world. Yes, it's maybe not all real, but the real stuff is there too. The real Holy Spirit is moving all around the world. And the Lord says, if you're thirsty, come and drink, come and drink, come and drink, and be satisfied. And be overflowing. The church needs the Holy Spirit. We need the inflow of the Holy Spirit in our life, because without it, what we are just, well, we call it church, but it's just a morgue. And once a week we come together acting in religion, turning over in our grave. That's what we have without the Holy Spirit, because there is no spiritual life outside of the Holy Spirit. We need to be quickened to new life. Yes, that is because of Jesus. That is because of what he has done on the cross. It is because he took our place. It is because he shed his blood for us. But the quickening is a work of the Holy Spirit that is made possible through the blood of Jesus Christ. But he is the agent, I could say. The Holy Spirit is the agent that brings that divine life into us and makes us to rise out of our grave and to be alive in him. Hallelujah. I'm alive. I'm alive. Now, you know, sometimes you see somebody dancing and you think he's alive. And then you see a coffin and you say, man, that's dead. But the Lord might say, well, the one dancing is dead and the one in the coffin is alive. It all depends who has Jesus in their heart. It all depends who has been quickened by the Holy Spirit. Yeah, you know, let me give you an example. Now, think of Switzerland with all those cottages there, and it's winter. And there is a big layer of snow on those cottages. Some of your words are a little difficult. And there's a big layer of snow, icicles hanging there. The driveway or the walkway up to the door, it's packed with snow. You cannot come inside. It's dark. It's cold. There's nothing there except one cottage on that row. The snow is almost melted. The driveway is clear. The walkway is clear. The icicles on the windows are almost gone. And there's a light inside. There's a light of a burning fire inside. You know what the difference is? There's a tenant there. Somebody is living inside that cottage. And the one that's living inside the cottage has a fire burning there. And that heat of the fire is going from the inside through the roof, melting the snow that's on top, melting the icicles. He cleared the path to the door. That's the Christian that has the Holy Spirit burning in his heart. That's the fire that we have inside that makes all the difference. Else we'll just be like the other cottages. will just be as ice cold, as frozen, and there will be no life inside. You know, we must be quickened to new life. But you also need to be enlightened by the Holy Spirit. You know, I'm so thankful that the Holy Spirit enlightens us. And the first great way that he enlightened us is by giving us the Word of God. Because it says every word has been written by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. So without the Holy Spirit, you wouldn't have the Word. But now that he has given us the Word, don't think that you can understand it without the author of the Word explaining it to you, taking you into the truth, and illuminating your mind, illuminating your heart, bringing it into your inner man where it produces fruit. I like the way that a great writer said it. He said, you know, it's not that the Holy Spirit brings us to the entrance of truth and then lets us find our own way. He brings us into the truth. And then he shows us. It's just like when you go into those caves underground, you know, and they have the beautiful things inside the caves, and the guide takes you into that cave, and then he starts to point out and direct your attention to different things and explaining what's happened there and why it is so beautiful. That's the Holy Spirit. When he comes into your life, he starts to take you into the Word of God, and he starts pointing to things. You've read it 100 times. You never got its meaning. You never got the benefit of that word. But suddenly, one night, and I've had this in my life, and I'm sure many here has had it. Suddenly in the night, I wake up and I say, now I understand. Now I understand. Can I explain it? Not always. Many times it goes beyond my mind, but it's something in my inner man that I get it because the Holy Spirit shed light upon it. Because the Holy Spirit explained it, opened it up, shared the secret inside. And the funny thing is, some years later, there's a whole brand new meaning in it again. It's inexhaustible, the Word of God, when the Holy Spirit starts to lead you into it and starts to explain these wonderful things. You know, I must think of another example. There are two countries, and they're on the brink of war. And diplomacy is not working anymore. So the whole world is afraid that they will go at war with each other. But they have one hope, that the country who is so eager to go to war will not go into war, because that country is bankrupt. And when you're bankrupt, you cannot fight a war. Well, this is what we're having in the world right now, of course, with this great war in the Ukraine. Themselves, they are bankrupt. And if America and if Europe doesn't come to aid, they're finished within a few days. You cannot fight a war when you are bankrupt. You need to have something to pay your soldiers. You need to have something to buy weapons. You need to have something to buy vehicles and to take care of all that needs to be taken care of so you can fight the war. But you know, it's the same with Christians. When we are bankrupt of the Holy Spirit, how are we going to stand out against the enemy, against the forces of darkness? How can we take this world for Christ? How can we go into all those countries and places and bring salvation to them by preaching the gospel if we are bankrupt? We need the Holy Spirit. We need the power of God in our life. We cannot have an outflow if there has not been an inflow. And then remember that wise Dutch saying, you cannot pluck any feathers from a bald chicken. And a church that is bankrupt of the Spirit of God has nothing to offer to this world. Has nothing to give. You cannot give out of your emptiness. There must be something that has filled you up and that has come to overflowing. Even Paul says it so beautifully. Oh, I can read that verse. In Romans 15, verse 13, 18, 19, it says, and may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that the in believing that by the power of the Holy Spirit, you will abound in hope and overflow with confidence in His promises. I like that it speaks about filling. It speaks about up to the, you know, not to the bounds, but how do you say that in English? Beyond the barriers, beyond the bounds. Overflow, overflow, overflow. And then it says, for I will not presume to speak of anything except what Christ has done through me as an instrument in His hands, resulting in the obedience of the Gentiles by word and deed, with the power of signs and wonders, and all of it in the power of the Spirit. First, he talks about being filled up to the point of overflow. And then he says that same power that fills you and that makes you to overflow is the power through which we reach the Gentiles and bring them into obedience of the word. One more example then. You know the river Nile, a very important river for Egypt. And as it flows, it comes out of the heart of Africa there. I think the great wells are there in Kenya. And then it flows down all the way into Egypt and into the sea. And you know, when it comes into Egypt, if it, at a certain times of the year, goes over the borders, over the barriers, over the borders that are set, the measure in which it goes over the borders determines the fertility of the land. And it's the same with us as Christians. If we have that river of life coming in us, but also, as it says, out of our belly it comes up as a river flowing, the measure that it goes over the barriers, over the bounds, is the measure of fertility, is the measure of fruitfulness. But it's not at that point in Egypt that determines how far it goes over the borders. It goes back all the way to the beginning, to the high reservoirs of water. If they are filled in a great capacity, that water will flow down and make the river to overflow its bounds in Egypt. And it's the same with us. The reservoirs are filled. The reservoirs are full, but our connection with that and the way we have experienced it and allowed it to come into our life will determine how far it will overflow in our life and touch those that are around us. We need those high reservoirs, but we need to be connected to it, and we need to stay connected to it. Without that flow in our life, we have nothing to share with the world. But when that flow is there, it will make it alive. Hallelujah. It will make every testimony alive. It will make the impact that it had in our life to have an impact on the lives of others that are around us. Yeah, that impact of the Holy Spirit. It quickened us and made us alive. It enlightened us and made us to understand how rich we are in Him, the great inheritance we have, the great victory we have in Christ, and how we can share that with the world. But you know, that impact of the Holy Spirit, it has also brought in us that we came into the to come into the spirit of the adoption, that we know that we are a child of God. You cannot understand this without the Holy Spirit helping you. And there's a difference in between somebody walking still as a slave with the spirit of slavery, or someone that is walking as a child. It will have a different impact also in the church. And sometimes that spirit of slavery can come back to us in the church. Suddenly we you know, I'm doing all this for the church. I'm doing all this for the ministry. Where's my reward? Where, you know, where's the fruit? I haven't seen this or that. Where? And then we come into that spirit of slavery again, that we are looking for earthly reward. We are looking for, we're not happy anymore. We're not doing it out of love anymore. But as a child, as a son, as a daughter of the Most High, Our reward is love, and love is all we want. Love is all we need. As a child, we know how good it is in the house of the Father. As a child, we see the goodness of the Father flowing into our life. There's a difference in your attitude. There's a difference in how you talk, if you're talking like a slave or if you're talking like a son or a daughter. So that impact will be different if you walk as someone who has been imparted by the Holy Spirit, that knows I am a child of God. I am saved. I am one of His own. My name is in the book of life. I am His. Or if you're walking, it's such a burden to be a child of God. It's such a slave. All these complaints. The impact on your children, the impact on your surrounding will be different. And it has to do with what came in, what's going out. What's going out? Yeah, you know. That impact of the Holy Spirit, I like it so much. It makes us to walk around as a child of God. But you know, it does so much more. It also brings us into a different life of holiness. Now, of course, when you're saved at that moment, you're just as saved as you are when you die so many years later. I mean, there's no difference. At the moment you are cleansed, the moment you are redeemed, you're clean. But as you live with Him, there's a difference in having these outward obedience to the rules, and that you have a certain morality by which you live according to the outward standards that people can see. Or if you have the Holy Spirit inside of you that has changed your desire, changed your taste. Now you love what you once hated, and you hate what you once loved. You're a different man altogether from the inside by the working of the Holy Spirit inside of you, who desires holiness, who loves holiness, who rejoices in holiness, who leads us to walk closer with Him. I love that song that you sang this morning, you know, just a closer walk with Him. Yeah. Oh, and He walks with me, and He talks with me, and He tells me I am His own. I love that song, because how wonderful it is to have that not only from the outside, but to have it on the inside. He walks with me. He talks with me. He's with me. Hallelujah. Oh, that's fellowship with our God. That fellowship, you've been brought into that by the Holy Spirit. Because the Spirit knows how to commune with Spirit, but how can the flesh commune with Spirit? You need the Holy Spirit to help you and to bring you into that relationship with the Father, with the Son, and it also brings us in relationship with each other. As a church, how wonderful that we are together as one body. We took the sacrament this morning. We proclaim we are one with Him, but we also proclaim we are one with each other. One, and He is the head of us all. And we have been brought into that body also through the Holy Spirit. Yes, I know it is Christ, it is the blood, it is the Redeemer. But without the work of the Holy Spirit, we'd be watching on the outside. But now we have been brought inside that body. We have been made a member together with each other. And He helps us for us to stay one together. And we need that help sometimes. You need it in your marriage. You need it in your family. We need it in the church family. That the Holy Spirit will help us. That we will not let issues arise and tear us apart. But that through the love of God and through the Word, we will overcome these things and stay one in Him. You know, it's so wonderful to be one with Him. I was here yesterday for the prayer meeting. Prayer is so important. Without prayer, I think prayer could be in one way a gauge. I'm not saying it's the only gauge, but in one way a gauge. How the church prays, how the Christian prays, is in one way a gauge of how their relationship is with Him and how strong the power of Him is inside. If you never have a prayer life in the church and on your own at home, where is your fellowship? Where is the strength coming from? Prayer is important, but prayer, there's a difference in prayer. I've seen many people pray. As I flew all over the world, I sat next to many different people. I sat next to a Hindu priest, and he had those pictures of his gods, you know. And as we went on the takeoff lane, and the pilot did the thrust of the engines, you know, and a man, I tell you, he had those pictures, and he was he was praying, going so fast, and the faster the plane went, the faster he was praying, you know. I sat next to a Catholic man. Nothing wrong with Catholics, but you know, he had those beads, and the whole flight, he was going through those beads, you know. He was so fearful in that plane. And I was sitting there, and I just slept, you know. And I'd take a look and greet him and then sleep again, because I knew my Lord was there. My Lord was there with me. But in my heart, I was praying. I pray many times in the plane. I spend time in prayer, and I pray. But I'm not doing the beads. I'm not in repetitive prayers. You know, if you just have a repetitive prayer, then record it on your phone and just put it in a loop and let it just run all day, it has just as much of an impact. If it's just a repetitive prayer that somebody taught you, and you're just trying to go through those beads, you're just trying to go through those prayers, there's a difference in prayer. And there's a real difference when the Holy Spirit starts praying through you. He creates prayers. He writes prayers. And he puts them in your spirit, in your heart, and he himself even starts to utter those prayers through you. That's a whole different prayer life. Those are prayers that will be answered. Those are prayers with true, pure motives. Those are prayers according to the will of the Father. Those are prayers that will touch your family and your nation and the world. Those are prayers that are based upon the accomplished work of Jesus Christ. Those are prayers that tap into the promises that are there in God's Word. Olden promises that are just as powerful today as the first day they were prophesied or spoken to the prophets. And the Holy Spirit brings those promises and that accomplished work, and he prays. You know, this world needs prayer people like this. It's that, I forget his name now, I knew it a minute ago, from Scotland. And he was praying, and he shouted out, you know, that was not just like, that was a prayer that was birthed by the Spirit. That was a prayer that came out with groaning, that came out with self-sacrifice, that came out, Lord, give me Scotland or I will die. John Knox, thank you. That's a different prayer. That prayer, you cannot just pray that, oh, let me also pray that prayer. Lord, give me America or I'll die. It doesn't work like that. But the Holy Spirit, when he comes in, the inflow in, not just as a mystic power, but as a person with whom you are a partner now, and you have come to the surrender unto him, that he can have his way and go his way, and starts to move you and bring you to that point where you're just on your knees, or you're just laying before the Lord. Maybe just gently moving your lips. I remember, you know, those wonderful meetings like what I just mentioned, with songs like, oh, when the saints, and everybody's dancing, and everybody is, you know. I remember just a few months ago, I was in the archives and I found a picture of our, it was a picture of the platform of our main church. It was a black and white picture. It was long ago. I was a little child. And people were laying everywhere, slain in the spirit. And I was on the corner of the platform. And you could see in the picture, my eyes, they are just in amazement there of what God is doing in that place. And I love those moments when there is such power and shouting and all. But I remember in my life also, I was kneeled in a park in front of a bench. And I was praying, and I had my head was in the bench like that. And you know, I heard the wind go through the leaves, and I heard the birds chirping. But suddenly, it stopped. I didn't hear anything anymore. And it was like the Lord Himself stood behind me. Silence. I couldn't pray anymore. I pushed my face deeper into my hands. You would say, look around. You want to see him, don't you? I couldn't. I couldn't move. I couldn't turn around. I didn't dare to look upon him. I don't even know if he was really there. But I felt his presence in such a way. It brought me to such silence in the throne room. You can't just walk in those places. The Spirit of God must lead you and bring you there. And there are times when you sing and shout and dance, but then you come into the Holy of Holies. You cannot say a word anymore, but yet the Spirit is praying, the Spirit is speaking, is moving. And in that silence, more is done in your life in that one instant than all your struggle and all your disciplines in years. I was a young man then, but that impacted my life, let me tell you. We need prayer like that. The world is a mess. America is in a mess. Europe is in a mess. There are powers at work that are far greater than you and I. But yet, when we come in that throne room and the Spirit starts to intercede, mountains can be moved, darkness can be pushed back, nations can be opened up, chains will fall down, deliveries will take place, salvation will come to the world, things will happen. And how, if we are not thirsty enough to seek and to come to the prayer meeting, to have a prayer life at home, to let him change us, that we are not just holy from the outside, adhering to the laws and the things, but that we have a changed heart, a changed nature. We are walking in that nature. It's changed, but now that we are walking in that nature, that we know that we are alive in Him. We are not a slave in bondage, but we are a child of God. You know, in Holland, when you go visit someone, you ring on the door, they open the door and you wait. You're with your coat and all, you wait until the one inside says, won't you come in, please? Then you wait in the hallway until they say, oh, you can go into the living room. And then you stand with your coat until they say, can I take your coat, please? And then they ask you, would you like something to drink? Yes, what would you like? Coffee, please. Okay. And they bring out the special cups for guests. Beautiful cups, but small. That's the special guest cup, you know, small cup. Yeah. And you sit there and you, yeah, okay, you have fellowship. Now, how different it is when my son comes home, you know. He don't do the bell because he has a key. He's living on his own. He's married, but he still has the key. So all I hear is on the stairs. Then he don't always come into my room. He'll go to the kitchen, open up the refrigerator, whatever is there and whatever is to his liking. He don't take out the small cup. Hello. He takes out the big gulp, or, you know, the mug, the family mug, takes it out, pours it, kicks off his shoes, sits on the couch, puts his feet on, not on the side table, but on the thing we have for that. Hey, Pop, how you doing? Coat somewhere in the hallway. Sometimes on the coat rack, sometimes in front of it, but it's there. How different to know that you're a child, to have the key, to be able to be intimate. Now, I'm not saying there's not protocol when you go to the Lord, but how different to go as a guest who doesn't really know him at all, who is a stranger in the house, or to go as a child, as a son, as a daughter, visiting your father, living with him, dwelling with him. Now, I must close, my time is up, but that, you know, finally, the Holy Spirit, when he comes, he's the great comforter. And we need that comfort as we go through life. I mean, things happen around us. Things happen in our life just as in the lives of people who don't believe. Our brother lost a tooth. It happens. Also to the great anointed legend man of God, Jimmy Swaggart, he also lost a tooth. Impossible, you would say, and I would agree, but still, things happen also to us. But we have the great comforter. What a difference. What a difference. When you're going through maybe a time of cancer or a lack of job or work, all these things, but you're walking through those periods with the comforter who is comforting you, giving you joy, peace, happiness, allows you to sleep at night. Others couldn't sleep in those circumstances, but you're sleeping. I sleep well. Sometimes my wife has to put my second leg in the bed because I'm already asleep. I came down with one leg and I'm gone. But you know that word, comforter, it's translated comforter. It comes from a word, paraclete, paracletos. I don't know how you say it in English, paraclete. And that also means advocate. Now, not between us and the Father, because Christ is the only advocate there. But he is the advocate between us and other men. He was there with Paul and Peter, and he was there with Jesus. He was there with all those disciples as they were being attacked. And the forces of religious spirit were so vehement. It was so anger, such a hatred, you know. But you know, the Holy Spirit was in them, defending them, helping them to know what to say, helping them to know what to do, doing a miracle that the man was raised. He was crippled. He was raised. They're attacking them, but the Holy Spirit already provided in a defense that the man was standing there, healed, dancing, leaping. They didn't know what to say anymore against them. Never forget, you're never alone. You're never alone. The Holy Spirit will tell you what to say when you need to say it. It will come out of your mouth. And he will defend you. He will defend the kingdom. He will help you with miracles and things that will make others speechless. Oh, my father had it so many times. I've had it so many times with interviews and the great reporters that knew how to get somebody, we say in Holland, under the table. They could talk so good, they'd talk you under the table. But the defense of the Holy Spirit surprised them. They didn't know anymore how to respond to those things. One time, I need to tell you quickly, sorry for, but you know, one time my dad was in a program. And they had a worldly piano player who wrote a song. This is Masbach. He is and saying all these in the song, all these bad things. He's a preacher without any degree. He's a liar and a cheater and all these things. He made in a song like that. And my father was sitting there listening. Nice tune. And then the host, he said, "Now, Mr. Masbach, you can respond to that song." He said, "Oh, well, for this occasion, I brought my own pianist, and I would like to respond in a song." Well, they never had that in the program, you know, like, what's it? Okay, well, I guess that's okay. You know, so the piano player came, and my father had a picture of Jesus with the cross on his back. He took the picture, and he had the words there to help him, you know, because of the situation there. And he knew the song, but just, you know, sometimes you can get nervous in those circumstances. So he had the words there. And instead of responding like, "Well, you know, I do have a degree, and, you know, I'm not a cheater," and that's how they always responded to that song. But he responded, "He was wounded for my transgressions, and he was bruised for my iniquities. But surely he bore my sorrows, and by his stripes I am healed." What a response! That was the Holy Spirit. Not defending himself like, "I am righteous." No, he said, "Yes, your song is true. I don't deserve it, but he was wounded, yeah, for my transgressions." Are you here this morning? You need forgiveness. Oh, if you need forgiveness, let us all rise up. I want to close in prayer. Oh, hallelujah. Maybe you can softly sing it on the back, but this morning, if you need forgiveness, let's first pray for that. And I want to direct myself especially to those who are watching at home. If you need forgiveness right now, the Holy Spirit, the Lord himself, is there with you in your room, in your car, wherever you are. And he hears that prayer that you say, "Oh God, I come to you. I'm a sinner. I don't deserve it, but I don't want to die without you. I don't want to go as the song Brother Jimmy sang. I don't want to have a house of gold, but that my soul is lost. No, I rather lay in a grave, but know that I am saved." Today, pray this prayer and say, "Oh God, save me, save me. I need salvation. I believe that Jesus is your son. I believe that he paid the price for my sins upon the cross. I believe that he died and rose again. And today that you will forgive me on account of what he did for me, taking my place for the punishment. Cleanse me, make me whole, holy and acceptable before you right now, Father. In Jesus' name I pray, hallelujah." And everybody else here, are you thirsty? Are you thirsty this morning? Just lift up your hands and say, "Lord, I want to drink. I have been drinking this morning, but I want to drink more, Lord. I want those reservoirs not to be shut up and closed, but I want them to be open and to flow into my life, Lord. That fountain will erupt out of my inner man, out of my belly. I want to be beyond the bounds of who I am, Lord. I want it to overflow, Lord. Overflow, Lord. Let your spirit come in a greater measure, in a greater way. Let it work in me. Let it birth prayers in me. Let it help me to walk according to your will from the inside out. Lord, that I may know I am a child of you, even when I don't feel it sometimes, even when I feel those lies of the devil pushing me away. Let your Holy Spirit come and help me that I am your child by grace, and I may walk as your child with you and talk with you and fellowship with you, the Father and the Son, and with my fellow brothers and sisters. Let that river flow, let it flow, let it flow like never before in my life, and bring fertility and bring fruitfulness, Lord, all around me. I thank you for
doing this in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. God bless you. I look forward to seeing you tonight.
Did you enjoy that this morning? Ushers, bring our boxes. Hallelujah. Bless Brother Mosbach this morning. We are encourage you to be generous in your blessing to him. Didn't we enjoy that word this morning? If you make out a check, make it out to Family Worship Center. March around right now.
And enjoyed this live service from Family Worship Center. Family Worship Center, located in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, at Jimmy Swaggart Ministries, holds three services weekly: Sunday morning at 10 a.m., Sunday evening at 6 p.m., and Wednesday at 7 p.m., all Central Time. All services are broadcast live on the Sun Life Broadcasting Network, Sun Life Radio, online at sunlifetv.com, and on the free SBN Now app. To join the Family Worship Center Media Church, call 1-800-288-8350 or join at jsm.org. Live services are produced by the Sun Life Broadcasting Network.
Behind every song is a story.
In time.